Our first speaker is Dr. Dhananjay Rai. So Dr. Rai did his PhD from the Center for Political Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University, and is currently assistant professor in the Center for Gandhian Thought and Peace Studies at the Central University of Gujarat, Gandhinagar. He has published on various themes in Indian politics in well-known journals such as Economic and Political Weekly, Social Change, and Indian Journal of Public Administration. And the title of his talk today is Gandhi and the Category of Adivasis, Understanding Extra-Parliamentary Vocabulary. So I invite Dr. Rai to begin his talk. You have 20 minutes, and I will send you a reminder after 15 minutes. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Nishan. Thank you, Dutna, for this wonderful opportunity. Thank you, Professor Kanungo and Dr. Smith and co-panelists, Dr. Bina Senga and Dr. Sangeeta Dasgupta. This is a part of my work on, and there would be an important category called Adivasi, the part, and maybe I may not be able to comprehensively deal with the concept and category, but the idea is this, that how Gandhi invented, Gandhi formulated, or Gandhi was for the term called Adivasi, not any other term. And this is a very important to understand the understanding of extra parliamentary vocabulary. And when I'm saying that understanding extra parliamentary vocabulary, I'll come to that point later. But my point is that the state-led categories of people who are aboriginals or originals had limitation that those categories made people contingent upon them in terms of survival and in terms of constant recognition over their own rights. And you look at the trajectory of Gandhi, and it throws a very, and by the way, the limitation of my presentation would be that I am just focusing on Gandhi and Gandhi's contribution therein. I'm not at all dealing with the Gandhian movements or Gandhism or Gandhian theorists. I'm not doing at all. That is different. I can come back to those things later on, but I'm just dealing with the Gandhi and the category of Adivasis. So category of Adivasis is a very important and significant name. Gandhi, to juxtapose or to transcend the limitation imposed by the category of the state where marginal people become more marginalized because the immense Weberian state have immense power on two accounts. One is violence and second is legitimacy. So violence and legitimacy become powerful tool of the state in terms of giving rights to the people, even that those rights are their own rights. A category of Adivasi has been interpreted differently, and it shows that exclusion of tribes in Kumar's work, or in Eka's work is a subaltern status. Dietrich talks about Adivasi in terms of tribal rights. Biswamaypati used to use Adivasi as a resistance, and Vishwanath uses term as a protest. Hardiman uses Adivasi as an assertion, and this is from his famous work. So, and I think Professor Khaka is also agreeing with the term Adivasi, and he says that the use of term Adivasi to describe tribal people seems to have some validity even in the sense of marginalization. Historical antiquity may have been a more distant criteria, but the most immediate and proximate seemed to be the fact that they were not part of the civilization. In a certain sense, then there was an aspect of marginalization that was taken note of while designating a group as the Adivasi. And unlike various other categories where Gandhi involved himself or other people involved in Gandhi was also associated with the various categories. Category of Adivasi is very different from the various categories invented and associated by and with Gandhi. And if you look at the Gandhi's trajectory from 1925 to 1948 or 48 is very interesting. And if you look at his writings in 1925 and 1930, particularly if you look at his writing in 1925 in Young India, and there was a Bihar note, and here you'll find the first time Gandhi is seriously engaging with the Adivasi question, and the title was With Aboriginals. But the engagement and the contour and the language was very peculiar. And in 1925, he was almost, they are very good. They have a very good body of good, interesting men, most interesting body of men and women, simple children. These were the remarks initially in 25. And he's mentioning meeting Ho tribes and Munda's tribes, and also the description is juxtaposed with the missionaries. So Gandhi mentions and describes his acquaintance and his association with tribes in contrast to Christian missionaries. Though he appreciates Christian missionaries, but he's also critiquing their engagement. And this, he says that in the end, actually, it is nothing but conversion. So the Gandhi's entry point to Aboriginal question and Adivasi question is a very peculiar, that is a very, very paternalistic and also is in comparative manner. And that comparative manner gives him sense. But this was Gandhi in 1925. But if you are from 1925 to and in between, there are lots of engagement with the Adivasi question, not directly by Gandhi, but by several other people. See, I'm skipping some of the parts because we don't have time, but come back to 1942. Again, Gandhi, from 1925 to 1942, the publication in Harijan on 18 January, where he talks about the Christian intervention and the Christian here again he talks about that the Christian intervention is becoming more important and they are more humanitarian, they are doing lots of work. But what his point is that there is a suggestion by Thakkar Bapa, and the Thakkar Bapa was a very, very important person in terms of associating with the Adivasi struggle. Gandhi, and I bring here that from 1925, the language, the contour and the term, and 1942 onwards, there's something happened between Gandhi, and the Gandhi has important contribution in 1941. And the contribution was the writing of constructive program. There was a constructive program, and the constructive program is a very, very important intervention and innovation in Gandhian schema. And the constructive program, I would like to suggest that must be read as extra parliamentary program. Because in liberal state, and I'll come to the point that why liberal state has no place for the constructive liberal theory, and constructive program has to be extra parliamentary. It doesn't mean that abandonment of main resource of parliament, but extra parliamentary means that giving more power and more spaces where you can actually come out or overcome the limitation of the liberal state. For example, Gandhi published something called Constructive Program, its meaning and place, four times: 1941, 1944, 1945, 1948. In 1941, you had 13 items. Adivasis were not included in Constructive Program. 1944, he had 14 items. Gandhi had not included Adivasi's question. But what happened in 1945 that he had included Adivasi questions? And this was the 15th item in Gandhi's constructive program. And if you look at the 1948 constructive program, Gandhi also had included Adivasi as an important category of the constructive program. Why constructive program is important, and what is the language of constructive program vis-a-vis Adivasi? Now Gandhi, look at the language of 25 and the language in 1945, there's a stark difference. And here Gandhi is, in place of understanding Adivasi question and the category of Adivasi in a paternalistic sense or in a competitive or comparative sense, here Gandhi is talking about language in associational sense. The language of 45 becomes the language of associational. And here Gandhi makes in 1945 edition, the constructive program, Adivasi as an important component. And he says that it was, and he gives the credit to Adivasi vocabulary or terminology to Jugat Ram, and the Jugat, and he says that the Jugat Ram was a very important person who contributed to the construction of the vocabulary of Adivasis. And by the way, and of course, later on, he is also giving credit to the Chakkar Bapa. And here he says that the service of Adivasi is also a part of the constructive program. Though they are the 16th number in this program, they are not the least in the point of importance. Our country is so vast and the races are so varied that the best of us cannot know all there is to know of men and their condition. As one discovers this for oneself, one realizes how difficult it is to make good our claim to be one nation, unless every unit has a living consciousness of being one with every other. So the living consciousness, it becomes very important in the context of Gandhi. The language and the concern shifted from 1925 to 1945 edition of constructive program. Even if you look at his discussion with the Midnapur political workers in 1946, January 2nd, Gandhi is actually, and this is a very interesting point which Gandhi is raising, and there was a 1935 Act, and the 1935 Act, in place of giving rights to Adivasis, they had given some part of, and that was also contingent upon the recognition and legitimacy by the state that Dalits, tribals could have those rights. And Gandhi is very, very categorical that he says that the 1935 Act had separated them from the rest of the inhabitants of India and had placed the excluded area under the governor's direct administrator. Now, the problem is that this administrative and the state involvement may be, well, it is required to some extent in case of the denial of rights. But in place, if indigenous community or Adivasis, in place of them deciding their land and where they are living for centuries, state becomes important stakeholder by 1935 Act. And the Gandhi was a bitter critic of this, that in place of giving them land and their rights, the state is appropriating idea of violence and the idea of right, of recognition, of redistribution to these communities. If we come back to the 1946, again in Guwahati speech at political workers conference, Gandhi is talking about that the collective fight and the collective consciousness and the collective rights are very, very, very important. And he rejects the policy of the isolation and the policy of isolation and not the policy of rights. So state, in place of giving rights over the resources, adopted the policy of isolation in place of rights. So isolation became a very important category in terms of the state discourse, which was used often in terms of giving rights and not giving rights. So this was Gandhi's critique, and All India Congress Committee, June 14, 1947. And he says that, and this is the language which he was developing from 1925 onwards. And he says that if you say that untouchables are nothing, Adivasis are nothing, then you are not going to survive yourself. This was a bitter critique of both the state, British India, British state, and also the Indian National Congress, that if you don't have a concern, an associational concern, it becomes very difficult even in terms of your survival. This is Gandhi's backdrop and the construction of vocabulary and the semantics or meaning of Adivasis through different phases. I say that when Gandhi was treating Adivasis without the constructive program, his language was different. And when, as soon as Adivasis become part of the constructive program, the language and the concern and the contour became very different. And I say that the constructive program as a text must be treated as an immanent text. The constructive program has to be read as an immanent text. And I say that there could be a three categories of text, major text and fragmentary text and immanent text. The immanent text, unlike the liberal political theory or statist discourse, in which contradictions are saved by protected realm of politics, both in terms of theory and practice, immanent text becomes significant representation or career of extra parliamentary politics due to thinking immediacy, resurfacing contradictions, creating multi-space of politics, perceiving everything political in terms of converting number of spaces into the political spaces, and adopting the centrifugal approach as to threatening the structure from within while going outside the structure. So if we read constructive program in this manner and as a part of the immanent text, we will have an important discussion, and the Adivasi question in Gandhi through the constructive program became the question of immediacy, resurfacing the contradictions, creating multi-space of politics, perceiving everything political, not only the state policy vis-a-vis isolation or vis-a-vis giving certain land rights, but every act became political act of the state and the political parties vis-a-vis Adivasis. And this is centrifugal in a sense that it was going from within to outside in terms of exposing the realm of multiple politics. The Adivasi question couldn't remain a very sanitized question, I think. There could be lots of contradiction, and there are lots of, but in terms of becoming significant and becoming political, it gained currency through constructive program. What is extra parliamentary? I'll take some time and then I'll conclude that the extra parliamentary is the arduous mechanism of liberal political theory and liberal democracy by way of separating political equality and economic inequality, defining a space for political pursuit, and envisioning agent to have access to political space, and further reducing the idea of delegation, representation, and representation of the will of political majoritarianism constitute the parliament pursuit. So in liberal democracy, there is a division between political equality and economic inequality. There is a space for politics, and this space is accessed for through politics of delegation, and this delegation is represented through the will of political majoritarianism, which constitutes parliament. This political majoritarianism, and or in this framework, a derision of or deviation, this political is not desired, is a violation of general will of people. This act is construed as the extra parliamentary by the liberal state. I mean, any act which is outside the political space of the liberal state or political space of the state can be is construed by the extra parliamentary by the liberal state. I would say that there could be many ways to be fitted into the category of extra parliamentary. Action could be extra parliamentary without questioning the liberal conundrum. Right-wing popular politics, religious fanaticism, communitarian assault on individual rights, even terrorism or revivalism could also be categorized as the extra parliamentary category. The hollowness or severe deficiency in these groups is not the only non-engagement of a liberal conundrum, but also talking to the political into identity questions. The alternative to the liberal conundrum cannot be a regression into pre-liberal days, but going beyond the liberal edifice. In this sense, I will define the extra parliamentary as the construction of a space of political action or public action, which defies the logic of the particularities of a space and authorized representation of the space. What happened that the various categories liberal state and liberal mechanism had created, two are very important. That is the particularities of space and the authorized representations. And the particularities of space and authorized representation had decided the Adivasis questions in terms of the land rights, in terms of their representation, contour of language, contour of everything, everydayness. So what is the particularities of space? I mean, the particularities of space that state designates some space as a politics, that is the, and if you are not raising those questions in those spaces, your questions can't be construed as a political questions. Those questions cannot be construed as a political question in the liberal democracy. And there would be authorized representative of these particularities of space. And these two important conundrums of liberal democracy have marginalized Adivasis the most, because they could not belong to this particularities of space due to variety of reasons, and there was no authorized representation for them. So in this way, particularities of space and authorized representative of the space they were excluded from various aspects. The possibility of this way, I mean, I'm saying that extra parliamentary is explored by way of reading not is a constructive program in two senses. Idea of redefining a space for the political and issue of deconstrained representation. So we need to redefine the political and the idea issue of deconstrained representation. I mean, there are not only some institutions which are representing us. In other words, rejection of the double rejection, that is the space I'm representing, is explored in the constructive program of Gandhi. Now, the term Adivasi, which could be construed simply as the original inhabitant, unlike liberal bourgeois recognition of bearer of consumer being, defies the logic of particularities of space, that is only limited space of politics, and authorized representation, that is only recognized representation of the space constructed in the liberalism. The category of Adivasi in terms of extra parliamentary, it redefines the idea of a space for the political and deconstrained representation. And this idea of political space or reclaiming political space and deconstrained representation may not be available vis-a-vis Adivasi and Gandhi in the earlier reading of Gandhi's engagement. But 1941 or 42 onwards, or four versions of constructive program, in last two versions, Adivasis are very much present in the language. They give scope for the reclaiming the political space and deconstrained representation. In a sense that vocabulary of Adivasi has to be read vis-a-vis Gandhi in terms of outside the liberal political theory in terms of giving politics, political space and deconstrained representation. These are, thank you so much. I hope I had more than 15 minutes, but I'll end. Thank you.